We just don't have them anymore. And even when they get ordered, we don't know if we get a hearing, get a process, bring forward the information, notice and comment, let the people know. I know the Melanchthon people are here. They have an environmental process at least to make the decision and to look at the evidence. Whether or not they get a hearing will be the next step. That is where they have someone independent to make the decision as opposed to people who've been lobbied behind closed doors. But we haven't had one in years. The Ontario Energy Board no longer does hydro reviews. Ontario Hydro, with its nuclear plants with once through cooling, killing millions of fish every day because they don't want to put closed cycle cooling in. Every day on Lake Ontario, the fish on this lake are so devalued that they're not even worth saving. We don't have hearings any longer into what we're going to build, whether it's coal plants or nuke plants, distributed power, decentralized power, whether we're going to bring power in from Alberta through pipelines and bitumen and refineries. How is Ontario going to build a clean, renewable future? No longer are those made at the Ontario Energy Board. I was a lawyer at the demand supply plan hearing when the same plan that we're looking at today came forward, went to a hearing, and after two years, it wasn't what people think that they couldn't get it through. It's the whole plan fell apart under the light of day. Their assumptions, their plans no longer held up. It wasn't in the public interest, so they withdrew it. The government didn't cancel it. The whole hydro withdrew it, and thank goodness they did. Because they had plans to double what we have currently, twice as many nuke plants and twice as many coal plants. Because they predicted by today, you know, there wouldn't get natural gas would be through the roof, which is at 60-year lows now, but they predicted that we'd have all this need for power and we'd be selling it into the states and we'd be rich. And yet every one of you are paying a $10 billion debt retirement on the bottom of your electricity bill for nuclear power plants and the mistakes they made in the past. And those would have just doubled that. And it was the hearing process and the public asking questions that stopped that. And now federally, the federal government, they created the Management Projects Office 5 years ago in Vancouver. And its job was to get rid of all the environmental legislation that stood in the way of industry. And so what they did 3 years ago is took away our Navigable Waters Protection Act. As a lawyer on the Great Lakes, I use that piece of legislation almost every time to get public discussion and let communities know when projects are taking place that might block their right to paddle, to canoe, to use the water freely. Something that goes back 1,000 years that each one of us as Canadians, how Canada was built, is that if you could put a boat on it and you could float it, you could paddle anywhere and nobody could stop you. And in order for the government to take that away, they'd have to give public notice, have this little hearing, and if they did block it, then the public would get in there and maybe get an easement so they could portage around it. Now those hearings are gone. And those easements aren't being put in place. And many of these old navigation routes are being lost. And for the First Nations communities, this is serious stuff. This is their stories and their histories, and this is where they're, how still to this day, we have a Moose Riverkeeper, William Tozer, a Cree, he's on the old Hudson Bay area, 200 square kilometer area of hunting and trapping. And I can tell you that he loses his boats sometimes because the dams, when they let the power out or the water out, he doesn't know. There's no notice to the community when that's happening. He doesn't know which fish are full of mercury and which ones aren't, which rivers are polluted. All that funding for sampling is gone. And as we heard today, in terms of water, the crisis in water in the north is tragic. And that's why this year, one of my supporters, tragically hip, and Gord Downey and Joseph Boyden, who's president of the Moose Riverkeeper, we flew up to Fort Albany and participated in the Great Moon Gathering to show support for those communities and to learn about where they get their water and why they have so many problems. And so when you think then today, the federal government now says we're going to have no more environmental assessments unless we say you should have one, no more mandatory ones. And if we do have them, the National Energy Board or the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission are going to do theirs. We're not going to have independent assessments. We'll give it to the industry regulators to look into it. We're going to shorten them, and we're not going to let environmental groups get involved unless they have a stakeholder's interest. In other words, unless you have a vested interest in the project. Imagine that. And then they took the Fisheries Act. And what they're saying about the Fisheries Act is they want to say, we're going to build in exemptions to all these laws. Operating a work or undertaking that destroys fish habitat, depositing a deleterious substance into water is frequented by fish. And we're going to create opportunities for exemptions, no longer governing council regs, but ministerial discretion. So if you come in and lobby me and you get your water, your watershed, your industry, or your toxin, are all listed as the three things that can get exemptions, you can get an exemption and argue that you shouldn't be held to those national standards anymore. And you know who's lining up. Energy industries, nuclear power plants. Imagine, you think the Don River's ever gonna get any protection any longer? Those old rivers that we've ruined and that the communities hope to restore one day, you think they're gonna be able to go to the Fisheries Act again and argue that there's an economic interest or that they should be protected? When the legislation now says that we're only looking at the big stuff that we have left, big projects, we're not gonna give hearings for anything else, and you have to prove the change in the onus. They're saying that you now have to prove that there's an economic, recreational, or cultural value to the fish. Well, A, that's just pure nonsense anyways, because we all know right from the bent, the community and the ecosystem approach, right from the worms to the big fish in the middle of the ocean, that they all have value and they're all interconnected. But remember, this says that they can now say, no fishing signs along here, and there's no protection for this area. Currently under the Fisheries Act, everything's protected if there's a fish in it. Amazing to me that signs that'll say no fishing will now allow them to push forward the discharge points for sampling. They'll say no more, you know, protection for these areas because these fish have no economic value. Lake Ontario. We don't have a commercial fishery on Lake Ontario except for at the very far end. How much protection do you think the fish of Lake Ontario are going to be given?
Nothing.
How much protection are areas in the far north going to be given when there's no one up there, there's no commercial fishery, and maybe it's just a small little area where the little community, a First Nations community, or some little community goes out 2 weeks a year and catches fish for their family? How are they going to fight now? And so we're losing all our laws, and we're losing all our processes. So where are we? We're back in 1972. We're right back where we started, when the communities came together and demanded that this is our water. You can't take this away from us. You can't take away our freedom to participate in the decisions that are being made about this water and water body. And we demand an accounting, and we want to be involved in the process. The best way to do that is to have the Great Lakes declared a public trust. Because the public trust, at its heart, says that it's our water, and nobody can take that away from the community without our consent and without our involvement. So this is a very important time, and this is a very important tour. And each and every one of us have to do our part, not only to ask for the public trust to be adopted and pushed on our provincial government. Maybe now the provincial governments are in charge of the environment. We're not sure. Local governments. But it's also up to each and every one of you to understand your connection to the Great Lakes. We created that old beach guide we used to do is now an app. It's a free app. You can go to the App Store and download the swim guide. It has every single beach on the Great Lakes on it and gives you the history as to its water quality. What days it was open and closed, and it links to the public health units so you can find out where they are. It gives you directions, pictures, communities, who's involved, nice little stories. A great thing to learn about your public space. In terms of fish, learn about your fish. You're going to have to defend those fish. You're going to have to argue that they have value to your community. Otherwise, they are going to be on the exempt list of the Fisheries Act and no longer given the protection of the law. And you need to know where your drinking water comes from. I was counsel in Walkerton, and I know sitting up there over the months and months with that community, what it did to many of us who were counsel, what we realized, the flaws in the laws and the lack of enforcement and the lack of meaning and force given to our drinking water, and how so many communities in Ontario are privileged to have clean drinking water, and it's not being seen as a right. It really is being seen as a privilege. And you need to understand drinking water. Where it comes from, what are the threats, who's making the decisions over its safety, what they're putting into it. And so we all need to do our part as part of the public trust doctrine, because if we own this lake, then you should know as much about it as you do about your house, or your wardrobe. I don't know if you have a nice wardrobe, I don't. I don't know much about my wardrobe. But you know, anything else you own, you need to know about it. It's yours. And if you don't understand it and get to know it and protect it, let me tell you, I know there's no one else out there doing it for you any longer. And that's part of the plan, isn't it? So let's get the public trust doctrine put in place. Let's understand that it's all of ours, beyond the states, beyond the provinces and the federal governments. We're a shared community. We all live here, the 35 to 40 million of us. This is such an important asset. 95% of the United States fresh surface water. 20% of the world's surface water, fresh surface water. what a privilege to live here, and what an opportunity for us to make a difference. So thank you for having me here. And thank you.
Thank you so much, Mark. Thank you so much. What a wonderful way to bring it all back to the point of origin, which is all of us in this room, and those of us who weren't able to come out tonight, but who we will connect with over the coming days, weeks, and months moving forward. We're going to have a bit of a question and answer period, but just some minor housekeeping items. I just want to make a note here. That everybody here is invited to the June monthly meeting of the Toronto chapter of the Council of Canadians. It's held June 6th at 7 p.m. at Toronto City Hall. I encourage everyone to come out and support the chapter, meet your fellow activists in the community, and how you can work together moving forward.
You can download the apps. You can go to your app store, it's iTunes or Google Play, or you can go to the website, www.theswimguide.com. .org, and there you can see it all on the website and your users, and you can get all the beaches. All the Great Lakes are up already in California and BC and Alberta. But things never disappear, and on the cooling water, Canada is the last remaining place that still builds or has plans to build nuke plants with once through cooling. Nowhere else, it's not legal in the States, and nowhere else in the world are they doing that. They use closed cycles, so you're not constantly sucking in the fish and killing them and the eggs, etc. So in terms of tritium, a few years ago Council Canadian was involved, Lake Ontario Waterkeeper, I believe there were over 79 different groups. It was called the Ontario Drinking Water Quality Standards in downtown Toronto. And after some review, the Ontario government made recommendations to reduce the tritium level from 7,000 becquerels per liter, which it currently is, the second highest standard in the world, it's Canada, only Australia's higher, to 10. So from 7,000 to 10. But there has been no movement on that by our federal government. So we just finished the hearing on a new nuclear power plant, the Darlington refurbishment, and they're still using the old standard. And so, you know, the basic science in Ontario was that you want to do everything you can to keep tritium out of drinking water. Everything you can. And if there's any tritium that's going to ultimately end up in our drinking water, we should be giving notice and warnings at 10 becquerels per liter. But the standard remains in Canada at 7,000. So when they say they're 100 times below the standard, don't feel that confident, because that would be 70.
Okay, well, wrap up thoughts. First of all, thank you all very, very much for being here tonight. It's just been fabulous. You've made our first night so special, and our speakers have just been unbelievably wonderful. Thank you. On the question on pollution probe, I do agree that I think that they're not as prominent as they once were. I certainly do know they spend a fair amount of time going after me these days, because they're quite pro-privatization, water privatization. So we disagree with them on that position, and then perhaps it is because they've taken a turn somewhere, and if anybody has any influence with pollution probe, do try to get them back on the straight and narrow. We're having a huge global fight around who is going to have the control around water, who is going to make decisions around water in our lives. There is the side that says that it is a commons, a public trust, a human right. It belongs to future generations as much as it belongs to us, that it doesn't, that it belongs to other species. It has rights in and of itself. That's a fundamentally different vision than bringing it into the marketplace, allowing it to be traded like energy and put on the open stock market, which is beginning to happen in a number of places, allowing it to be delivered on a for-profit basis by big corporations, bottled by big corporations, and so on. So these are very, very different visions, and it's distressing when an important organization like Pollution Probe, in my opinion, sits on the wrong side. I just want to say two last things. First of all, when we get discouraged, and I know this particularly Mark's remarks about the loss, it's not that we're just standing still. Like they did in the United States, there was a surge of good environmental legislation, both federally and provincially. And to hear Mark say that we're back to where we were in the 1970s is extremely distressing. And we're very distressed, all of us, at watching the details come out about what the federal government has done. I just wrote an op-ed piece on what it means for water, but you could do the same on air, on anything. I mean, they just cut huge number of employees from Parks Canada. Who's going to protect our parks? Who's going to protect the species and the water there? I mean, it's they don't care, and I think it's more than they don't care. I think this is part of a plan by people who are very clearly have an agenda to cut back on public services, cut back on public servants, to shift our working force over to the private sector, to bring in the cold shower of international competition through these trade agreements. The newest one with Europe goes down to subnational contracts. It means that you're going to find more Caterpillar situations where the people at Caterpillar were told you either take a 50% cut in your wages or we move. Lovely decision. This is going to happen more. And at the same time, open up the extractive industries, let anybody in, sign agreements that give corporations from other countries permanent access to those resources, whether you're talking uranium, fish, energy of all kinds, fracking and whatever. These trade agreements are locking in resource ownership by large corporations. New stat just came out that in the tar sands, 3/4 of the energy industry is now owned by foreign corporate interests. I mean, it's never been that high in all the years we've been working on this. When you're thinking we can't win, just remember that of course we can win. We just have to stay steady and be strong. I just got a wonderful notice. We're working with colleagues in Europe. As you know, they're going through this so-called austerity drive because they gave all their money to the banks in the bailout. So they've got no money for social programs, and now they're beginning to sell off all their water systems. They're literally selling the actual water systems in Greece, and they're privatizing their water services. And a coalition of people's groups from across Europe have come together in a People's Water Commission to demand water as a human right, and therefore it can't be privatized. Big win tonight, the European Commission has agreed to allow a European-wide referendum, and which I know they're going to win because when they had a similar one in Italy, they won by something like 90%. So when the people speak, we can make a huge difference. I just want to end by saying that when we have to have a combination of a deep sense of fight back, and I think we're going to see more and more people standing in front of bulldozers and standing up physically in front of egregious situations. I think we're going to see more, hopefully peaceful, but civil disobedience in this country and around the world as people move to protect what's left of the natural world. At the same time, we have to have a vision, and that's what we're trying to present with this notion of seeing the Great Lakes as one watershed, as a common watershed, a common heritage, a public trust, and a protected bioregion. And we want to have a dream that we are moving toward while we, as Lady Macbeth would say, in a not very nice situation, getting her husband to go kill, screw our courage to the sticking place, because we have a big fight ahead of us. We have 4 years ahead with the federal government that somehow got this majority, and those of us who are fighting the robo fraud thing, really, I don't think this was such a coincidence. We'll see what happens, and that's another big challenge the council's involved in. But we will fight every step of the way the dismantling of what has taken decades of people before us to build. We will do it. It will be hard. We will save these Great Lakes. It will take probably the rest of our lives to do, but what else have we got to do? Thank you so much.